Hotep, Hotep community, welcome back. First frequency of oneness, shock metaphysics. I am the metaphysical Morpheus. I'm not going to even go through all my AKAs because it's too doggone many, but some of y'all should know it right now. I see Chauncey Anderson in the audience. I see Go Travel Broad. I see Zachary Holmes. Welcome everybody who's coming in. My goodness, we have had an amazing 2 days. We had the Divine Feminine yesterday with Dr. Marie Charles. And today back with us on our weekly schedule is Dr. Clyde Winters talking about the Aztecs. How are you, my beloved God?
I'm just fine. You see, I got on my summer shirt, 70 degrees.
Oh, all right. You've got California temperatures now. That's great because that's what it is here, too.
Yeah, it might go down to below zero by tomorrow.
That's true. That's Chicago. It is. So, my beloved, did you get an opportunity to see Dr. Marie Charles yesterday and see the fruits of your labor and work and research? You're giving birth to research gods and goddesses around the world.
I wish I could take credit, but I read her 2010, 2011 article. So I know that she's been working a long time.
A long time.
I really enjoyed it. My car was messed up. You know, I had a tire blowout, so I had to have all new tires. So I could only listen to it. I could only listen to it on my phone. I would have been in the chat, or I would have been making some comments.
Because, sure.
You know, it was very powerful. I really liked a lot of this stuff. You know, a lot of it in terms of organizing the philosophy. You know, I went into the philosophy a little bit when I talked about how to study Afrocentrism. I went into the historiography, but what she did is that she went into the psychology behind Afrocentrism. You know, I thought it was real good. I liked it. I thought both parts, excellent. I especially like the second part. I like the H's. Mm-hmm. Eagles.
Yeah, that was genius. Yeah, that was really cool.
Yeah.
Because I had no idea. I'm sure you knew, but I didn't know. And 90% of probably the audience had no idea.
No, that's the first
thing. And the thing is that you go to school and this is what you're learning.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but see, the first thing they tell you when you take African history class, they bring up Hegel. And this whole idea that we had no culture, we had no morality and stuff like that. That's the first thing. That's you hear that in the first lesson.
Wow. Whew, unbelievable. Well, we are breaking the tides. We are interrupting that second frequency signal with hardcore facts and first frequency truth. So that and family, for those of you who are not a part of the 15-week course with Dr. Clyde Winters teaching us how to do research. We're now in the thick of it. It's phenomenal. I am absolutely loving it. It is making me a better researcher. It's making me a better writer. And so I just want to extend a personal thanks and gratitude to you, Dr. Winters, for the work that you are doing and what we're receiving as students of your work.
Yeah, thanks a lot. But this week the guys are going to be a little excited because everybody's. You know, over the years, I've always found that some people like to do their research projects together, and some people have the same possible proposal. So on Monday, everybody's going to tell us, what their proposal is, you know, their problem statement, their significance statement. So they're going to say that, you know, everybody's going to talk, unless they do.
Yes, sir.
Unless they fall on the rock. it's not really to punish people. It's just so that some of you guys may have a similar idea. And sometimes, let's face it, two heads are sometimes better than one.
True. Absolutely.
Two heads are sometimes better than one. And I'm very excited. We have a very good group, you know, and I think it's very important, very important. Mm-hmm. I think that people who have ideas need to work on them. You know, I'm really excited because I know one of the students in the class is talking about the Bible and how to incorporate, You know, I mean, we need some more research on that.
Sure.
Presented in a way so that people can really understand historical aspects of it.
Sure, sure.
They always teach you that there's no history. Most of the archaeology that they've done has been based on the Bible. So they just, you know, they just tell you lies. Europeans love lies.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, you're going to uncover more lies and give us more truths. Because today's lesson, you're going to be talking about the Aztecs. Why did you choose that?
Well, I chose the Aztecs because I've been a little bit interested in the Aztecs for a few years. You know, when mm-hmm. when I looked at their language, Nahuatl, I always knows there was a lot of Mandi influences, and also you know, Leo Viner, he talked about it. Harold Lawrence, he talked about it too, that Mandi influences. So again, the Aztecs are an interesting group of people, an interesting phenomenon.
Mm.
It's kind of a little hard to do the research because much of the research, much of what's written about them was written by people after they had been exterminated.
Mm.
Much of the information was written out by their enemies. Because mm-hmm. Once the Europeans, once the Spanish and the rest of them had conquered, many of them moved into Chiapas. So I really enjoyed it, and going back over some of the other materials was quite interesting. I think that people are going to enjoy it, and the PDF, I'm telling you, the PDF, you're only going to get it here. You only got to get
absolutely. I just put it in the chat, so everybody go get it because it's amazing.
And a lot of people down the road are gonna say, "Damn, I already talk about that stuff, but where can I find information? It's not all in my book."
Right, you know, right, absolutely.
Because I try to make the PDFs special. I try to make sure they have a little bit of things that you won't find in any of my books. And so then mm-hmm, that way, mm-hmm. you know, you're spending the money. But then again, I don't know. Because next week is going to be fantastic. You know, she does a lot of work with the Olmecs. And next week, mm-hmm. The one we're going to talk about next week, God willing, inshallah. Whatever, I think that's going to be really fantastic.
You know, that I'm going to say this, and it is one of those things where, brother, this is the 26th week. Next week will be the 27th. You have not had one bad lesson, one bad episode. Everything you do is amazing to us. I mean, so I'm just looking forward to the future with you because you just have this ability to literally change lives in real time and create so many jaw drops and eyebrow raises and aha moments. You're an amazing guy. You're an amazing elder, and we love you. And we're giving you your roses while you are above ground. And I'm looking forward to this 15-week course and beyond. I'm looking forward to all of these lessons. So we're going to get excited here, family. Now, Dr. Winter, I'm just putting up all of the love. There's so much love out here. I'm just putting it. I know, right? Dr. Winter is teasing us. Yes, he is. Yeah. So I know you have a PowerPoint for today, and let's get it on and popping because we're ready to get our socks blown back, our hair blown back. At least I can't blow back my hair. My beard will blow back. And let's make it happen.
Okay.
All right. Let's get that loaded up in the chat there. Fantastic.
Okay. So the
all right.
The Aztecs. I know this thing kind of looks gooey, but I like this. So you know.
I love that. I didn't even know you could do that. That's awesome.
Well, you know, I like to do a word. You know, I like to work with them, even though Google makes some good slides. I had my students when I was teaching, I had them use Google a lot. But, you know, because most schools don't want to pay for the program. So you go to Google because Chrome and Google is much more cheaper. But again, we're going to talk about the Aztecs. And the Aztecs are very interesting people. You always hear a lot of these Chicanos and a lot of Mexican Indians. And they always talk about, you know, they were the Aztecs. No, they were not the Aztecs. See, but because the Aztecs have such a great history, they really want to kind of steal that history. You know, they're always trying to accuse Afrocentric researchers of trying to steal their history. No, they're trying to steal our history. You know, I mean, you can look at some of these pictures that they go back to some of the canvases that relate to the Aztecs, even though many of these were written by non-Aztecs, because many of the Aztecs were exterminated. But even in these pictures, you can see how they show the difference between themselves. And but it's very sad. It's very sad that as Black people be one, it's very hard for us to find allies. Not too many people want to have allies. I'm down the road. I want to do a show to really elaborate this whole idea of the interactions, the militant interactions.
That's going to be awesome.
You know, I'd like people to join my Patreon. All the slides are in my Patreon. So if you want to be able to download copies of the slides so you can have a fuller experience in this talk, you have to join my Patreon site. Okay, my Twitter is at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. At Dr. Clyde Winters 8. And of course, I got almost 300 videos in YouTube. And these videos discuss all aspects of Black history. And in my Patreon, I have what's called movie guides. And in these movie guides, I discuss certain historical themes that relate to Black and African people. And these themes, you know, show you how to use my videos to really find more detail about it. Okay.
Fantastic.
There's 10 FBA historical truths that must be taught. Number one, we are Aboriginal Black Indigenous people, native to the United States. Number two, FBA ancestry is African. FBA heritage, depending on the tribal origins and presence in the varied states. You know, it's very important that we have this whole idea of FBA ancestry. I know there's a lot of our Aboriginal, people, you know, I mean, hey, I know I'm Choctaw, but what the hell? But some people want to go back to that old division. They're talking about, I don't want to be called Black. You know, people always want to run away from being called Black. They don't understand that it's in using the term Black that unites us.
Absolutely.
That's why the Europeans were able to take over America. They were take over Africa because you had these people who were racially Black, but they were always so nationalistic that it allowed the Europeans to come in and take them over. Our communities are messed up because so many people belong to these gangs. These gangs are like tribes. You see, and you had to find a way to stop that tribalism, you see, because this is tribalism that defeats people. You know, you got these cowards get out and shoot a gun. I know when I was teaching at in county jail, I was kind of, I was in my 30s then, 30s, 40s. So I can still duke it out. my old man taught me how to fight. But, but they didn't fight. By the time I got in fifth grade, people stopped fighting. They only use that trigger finger.
Right, yeah.
Fifth grade. Number three, Aboriginal FBA were the first slaves in the United States. Very important to understand. The first slaves in the United States were not from Africa. The first 100 years of slavery in the United States was Black Indians. In fact, the British, even before they set up colonies here, they were coming to America and kidnapping Black Indians and selling them to slavery. Number four, identity matters. Terms used to make FBAs invisible. They're always trying to make foundational Black Americans invisible. First, they called us color, you know. But see, it wasn't any color people doing slavery, because most foundational Black Americans were either Black Europeans, or they were Black Indians. And so, what the European did, he called the Black Indians color, and then what happened? We were called colored, and then they took away the Black Indian identity, and then made the Mongoloid Indians the Indians of the United States. And the Mongoloid Indians, a lot of them, they only recently came up into North America. Most of them was down in Mexico. Then after that, in the 40s and 50s, they started calling us minorities. And when they started calling us minorities, after a while, all the goodies went to the minorities. And the minority was what? White women. So they're the ones who got all the jobs from being, in a sense, promoted and stuff. And then finally, Jesse Jackson, he developed a term, African American. And I don't mind that people have used it, but many other people who've been able to use those African American scholarships that were supposed to be for foundational Black Americans were people from the Caribbean, people from Africa. And there's nothing wrong with that. The only thing wrong is that many of those people, when they do get a degree, instead of them saying, we all Black, then they start to talk about their various ethnicities. And so that's why it's very important that we have an ethnicity. Just like if you go to Nigeria and you find the Igbos, the Hausa, the Yoruba, they all live in Nigeria, but they all have their tribal name. And so we have a broad umbrella. And our tribal name is Foundational Black Americans, because that way, in a sense, if you say Black Moor, then you're against the Black Christian. If you're against the Black Christians, you're against the Catholic Jews and, Jehovah's Witness. Or you're against somebody. Right. See, religions, whenever you have a religion, religions encourage disunity, because religions, in a sense, encourage people to be in competition. You don't need competition. Foundational Black American is a name that gives us a nationality, and it gives us an identity. Number Facts. Five, 65,000 Foundational Black Americans fought in the Civil War to free themselves. Lincoln did not free the slaves. They did not give us freedom, because we were sitting around knitting and sitting around holding our hands and sitting around praying for relief, sitting around praying for God to save us. No, 65,000 Foundational Black Americans fought in the Civil War. They were about to lose the war. Look at some of the middle years of the war, the middle years of the Civil War. The South was kicking the North's butt. And they were kicking the North's butt because so many North white soldiers were deserting. They were deserting. But what happened is that after 65,000 Black men and women started fighting in the Civil War, they started kicking butt. And what happened? The North won the war. But they didn't win the war because of the fact, in a sense, that it was the nice Northern immigrants who fought. No, you were deserters. Black Americans fought for their own freedom. Number six, FBA culture is American culture. The food, the music, the language. Look how many of these white people who come out with cookbooks. Southern cookbook. Where to get the Southern recipe? The music. We made every music tradition in this country. May it be from country all the way up to hip hop. That's us. We even influenced the language. In fact, look at the colonialists. When you see John Washington, he's going around wearing some tights, right? Tights. You know what Black Indians were wearing back then? Trousers, what we call pants today. Yes, we even influenced their dress. The trousers.
One culture. The one culture, first culture.
That's
wow.
Right, first culture. And if not, they still be wearing tights. And they'd be having hair running up their asses.
Shout out to Mrs. PLC. I see you out there calling in and coming in from Cape Town. Cape Town is listening in. Thank you, my beloved. That is awesome. South Africa is with us. That is fantastic. Fantastic.
A lot of South Africans are riders because they know what we experience. people get in South Africa. South Africa, the South Africans, they came to America to see how to dominate a majority black population.
Yep, yep.
What they were doing here back there, you see?
That's right. That's
and they
right.
used it, but again, yes, we are the majority here, but we just shuck and jive, baby. You can call me a minority. Just give me the damn way to make the money.
That's right. That's right. Absolutely.
Play your game. Play your game, baby. Number seven. Foundational Black Americans built America before and after Europeans came to the United States. Yes. We built the railroads. We cleared the land. We worked on the farms, you see. American technological superiority was made by FBAs, yes. Yes. Every technological invention from the United States, not everyone, but just about everyone. I'd say about four out of five. Four out of five technological innovations were made by us. The cotton gin, the street light, the radiator to heat your home, the air conditioner. We made that shit. But my favorite invention, I say it every week and I say it again, is toilet tissue.
You ain't got no damn sense.
You
walk
got
away.
It was 11 of us, and when that toilet tissue ran out, my mama said, get that newspaper and crinkle it up. I still know how to rub that damn newspaper to wipe down.
I remember those days as well, my brother. I remember those days well.
Okay, number nine. Economic independence is obstructed by the dominant second frequency population. In other words, every time they see us about to make some money, maybe Rosewood, Black Wall Street, they destroy it. You see? Mm-hmm. We're hardworking people. But it's very difficult for us to be able to turn that into economic wealth. Number 10, Aboriginal FBA adopted Mongoloid Indians. Yes. Black Indians adopted the Mongoloid Indians. And second frequency, beginning with Benjamin Franklin. Beginning with Benjamin Franklin, he told the white folks, marry you an Indian. See, and they used the Indians, they used those Mongoloids as a buffer between them and us. The Europeans is always trying to find a buffer so we can be mad at somebody while they keep controlling the goodies. So these 10 historical truths have to be taught. I started saying them every week because I want everybody to know these are the things that every foundational Black American should know.
Absolutely.
You know, I'll tell you this, yesterday I was just so excited. Dr. Charles was talking about first sight consciousness.
And yes.
You got to see that video. You got to see it. You got to hear it explain it because, see, just like you got first frequency people. But it's hard to be first frequency unless you get
if you don't have the sight.
Right? Consciousness.
That's right.
To see who you are, what you've done, what is your future?
Absolutely.
Because this woman is teaching the stuff, man. I mean, hey, if you see that video, especially for those of you who want to really understand how to think about Afrocentric research, to understand how you really make your moves, how you develop a philosophy to give you first sight consciousness.
Absolutely.
See, when you accept this idea of first sight consciousness, then you can understand why some Black people think they're white and they have a second frequency, a second sight consciousness. They really think they're white. They believe they're white. You know that guy on the block who's got that American flag?
Right.
You better not tell him. So again, I hope everybody in the sound of my voice, you have to look at this video. You have to get knowledge.
And shout out to Reverend Billy B. Man Ra. He created the graphics for that. So the brother's got some skills, man. He's not just a minister that created the Black Room. He also got some skills with the graph. Well, he is an architect, by the way. So thank you, Reverend Billy.
But that's not all. He's a strategist. Come on now.
Oh, no question. No question.
I see this other stuff. He's a strategist.
Yes.
He's a
real talk
guy. Okay. Also, if you want to find out more about the Aztecs and other Mandy people in America, you might want to buy my new book. But I can tell you now, in my new book, I talk about the Aztecs, but it don't have the good stuff that's in the PDF.
In the PDF.
I love it. As I told you, I am really, you know, Rem, you really are right. I am mean. and the reason I'm mean
You earned it. You've earned it.
Yeah, but,
you know.
But I mean, because I don't put everything in the book, baby. I put some in the PDF. See, I want people to be searching. I want them to be on a treasure hunt. When I was teaching social studies in high school and eighth grade, I would always take my kids we would go to the Museum of Natural History, and they'd have a treasure hunt, and they'd have to go and find different things in different sections, especially the African section and the section on the on the people who lived in the Pacific Islands and stuff, you know, to kind of broaden their knowledge. And so in this book, I talk about the bilingual inscription that allowed me to decipher the Olmec writing. I talk about the Olmec calendar. I talk about a whole lot of things. I talk about the Mandy influence in North America, some of the stuff we already talked about. So if you really want to know, get this new book, The Mandy in Ancient America.
Fantastic. So, here's the million-dollar question. Were the Aztecs blacks?
Yes. Many Mexicans claim that blacks are stealing their history, although some Mexicans and Euronuts assume that the only blacks found in Mexico are descendants of African slaves. Yes. They think everybody in Mexico was a slave. No, they weren't. As I told people over the years, you know, black people have been in Mexico at least over a good 50,000 years. There was black people already in Mexico when the Olmecs came there from West Africa to the Chicano, to some of the Mexican Indians down there. They want to think in a sense that only black people came to Mexico as slaves, and that's a lie. Many Native Americans were blacks. One of the greatest Afro-American civilizations was the civilization of the Aztecs. Yes, the Aztecs were black.
Wow.
16th century author described them as follows. The people of this land are well made, rather tall than short. They are swarthy as leopards. Leopards! Swarthy as leopards. A leopard is what? Gestures, for the greater part, very skillful, robust, and tireless. And at the same time, the most moderate men known. They are very warlike and face death with the greatest resolution. What did they say? They are very warlike and face death with the greatest resolution. The reason that they were warlike was because those so-called Mongoloid Indians was always trying to attack them. They wanted to take away their greatness. Just like today, when you create a great civilization, people can see it. You can invite them in, but some people are ungrateful and they want to take them. The Aztecs were not Olmecs. They appear to be related to the Shira and Ocos people in appearance. Here we see right here a picture of the Shirla. The Shirla and Ocos people, their civilization goes back to around 2000 BC. That's over 500 years before the Olmecs came. See, black people have been in Mexico a long time. And the interesting thing about the Aztecs is they have that distinctive nose. If you look at this Shira lady and you look at the picture on the left, look at those noses. You can see in a sense that similarity, you know. There are many black Mexicans. Some of these black Mexicans are descendants of slaves, especially blacks on the Atlantic coastal region. But many of the blacks of Chiapas were never slaves. Yes. You go to Chiapas, those black people, they'll tell you they weren't slaves. They'll tell you they weren't slaves. They don't know nothing about no damn slavery. Most of the slaves were on the Atlantic coast near the shore. These people are called the Black Costa Chicas or the Negro Costa Chicanos. They live in a region where numerous artifacts have been found that indicate that black cultures thrived in Western Mexico, Belize, Honduras, and Guatemala. almost 2,000 years ago. Yes, yes. Before the Olmec sailed to Mexico from Africa and landed on the Gulf Coast of Mexico, they were already Negro Costa Chicanos. That means that there were black people in the Costa Chicas. They call themselves Costa Chicanos. Are we calling them?
So who was, is it the Malanchi? And why is it, why is she, or who was Malanchi, and why is she so important in the history of the Aztecs?
Oh, Malinche. It's very Malinche. We know that the Aztecs were Malinche, or Mandi people, because of the Spanish Aztec interpreter named Malinche, or Malinche. Think about that.
Wow.
They didn't call her. Her name was not Malinche. They called her the Malinche or the Malinche. Malinche. It appears that the Aztecs belonged to the Malinche Bambara tribe. Cortez was given a female Aztec translator. This translator was called La Malinche. Alonzo Mudacuma said she was a Mexica woman. Mexica, Mexica. The Aztecs, we call the people of the Aztecs, but the Aztecs, when Cortez asked them what their name was, they said, we are the Mexica, Mexica.
Absolutely amazing.
The Aztecs were Mandi speakers. They may be descendants of the followers of Master Abel Bakari when he left the Mali Empire to colonize much of the Americas. It's very important to remember that when Master Abel Bakari left Mali, he left Mali with over 25,000 people. They had canoes that big. It was just groups of people. There's evidence presented by Horace Butler and When Rocks Cry Out. This is a very interesting book by Horace Butler, you know, and his book is called When Rocks Cry Out. And what he found is that the Aztecs were Muslims. From Mali, from the Mali Empire. Butler used the Spanish documents to reach this conclusion. The name Malinche translates Malinche. The fact that La Malinche translates as Malinche means that the Aztecs identified themselves as Malinche. Here we can see, this is a picture going back to the time, and we can see Cortez leading his warriors. You can see they got the Indians carrying some packages, and you can see Malinche up in the head, because she was the translator. You know, the Aztecs said that they were Mexica. The name shows that the Aztecs were Mandi. It's also interesting to note that many Quiche, these are Mayan words beginning with the X, which is pronounced, correspond to words borrowed from Malinche Bambara with an initial S. In other words, in a sense, among the native people of Mexico, the X is pronounced as sh. You know, in the Quiche Maya, Malinche Bambara, we look at Shab, rain, and that relates to Malinche Bambara, sock. We got Isha, seed, and that relates X or K in the Mayan languages. For example, Malinche Bambara words that mean to sell, to buy in the market, this is related to man, to Mayan con, to sell. You know, then also we have the word can for serpent. In Quiche, the word kash, sky, corresponds to Mandi Saka. You can see some of the Majichi words, Jachachi, Kono, Achi, Man, Kye, Che, Bai, Ki, Kich, Haba. But it's very important is that I usually use the Delafosse list of words. And as you can see, in the Delafosse list of words, this is the Delafosse. He wrote his work on the Malinche Bambara language. It's in French, but you know, Delafosse, when he talked about the word si, it means it has the meaning of family, race, descendants, etc. Bruner, he said the word si goes with kind, type, race, and Delafosse found that si was a superlative of black, or noir, for black. So what does Mexica mean? Okay. We know that ma means master, lord, or owner. Si or she, it means family, race, or descendant, or it means black. And so the word Mexica, the name for the Aztecs, can mean either lords of the black land or masters of this racist land. Think about it. Mexica! They were telling you who they were. But see, it's just like what Dr. Charles said yesterday. If you try to interpret everything from a Eurocentric perspective, you will never find the actual meaning. You have to have first sight consciousness. That means you have to have a background in the history of Black and African people to understand where they're coming from. So Mexica, they're telling you right there, Mexica, lords of the Black land, or masters of this racist land, you know.
Wow.
The Aztecs were not native to Mexico. Montezuma told Cortez, and I'll quote, "We have known for a long time from the chronicles of our forefathers that neither I nor those who inhabit this country are descendants from the aborigines of it, but from strangers who came to it from very distant parts. And we also hold that our race was brought to these parts by a lord whose vassals they all were and who returned to his native country. After a long time, he came back, but it was so long that those who remained here were married with the native women of the country and had many descendants and had built towns where they were living. When therefore he wished to take them away with him, they would not go, nor still receive, lest receive him as their ruler." Oh, what do we know, baby? What did Mansa Musa, tell the Arabs? He said that Mansa Abu Bakari sent out a ship, and he sent his ships out to find a way to across the Atlantic. He said after a while, one of the ships came back. And then Mansa Abu Bakari gathered up over 20,000 people to leave. Do you see how this story matches? The story that Montezuma told Cortez matches what Mansa Musa told the Arabs about his predecessor, Mansa Abu Bakari.
Wow.
Here we see an Aztec elite.
This is incredible.
Aztec elite. Remember, we talked about the Mandingos. Many of the drawings of the Aztecs were done by non-Aztecs. This is from an original monument. Look at that face. Look at that face. Now, you ladies, don't get all excited out there. here we're comparing an Aztec, and we're comparing the monument. What do you see in common? You see them with those shorts. See those shorts coming out just a little below the knee? We see in the sense that we also see a lot of feathers. Many people believe that Africans didn't wear feathers, but that's not true. Many African groups wore feathers, but this is just to show you that relationship between the Aztecs and maybe the Himalayans.
Incredible. So how was the Aztec society organized?
Well, Dr. Aztec Winters? Society was organized, you know, usually in a sense it was matriarchal. The Aztecs lived in central Mexico and founded Mexico City. The people of central Mexico have traditionally been called Chilango. I repeat, the people of central Mexico are usually called Chilango. The term Chilango refers to the skin, color, and hair texture of the black people, the Aztecs who founded the city. Nahua people call the Aztecs Chilanco, and they call the Aztecs Chilanco due to their dark brown red complexion in comparison to the native Indian Americans. Yes, there's names. Look at these people. Look at the drawings that they left. And we know that they were called what? Chilango, which means that they had a black, they were dark skinned and had nappy hair, or kinky hair. Oh, don't get mad at me because I said nappy. I used my comb today.
That's right. We all heard the term keep the nappy happy. Let's do it. We know what we got to do.
Baby.
That's right, baby.
And also, also, don't forget, they also called them, in a sense, they also called them by that other name, you know, and they called them Shilanko, Shilanko. So again, we see this idea of blackness or darkness, you see. You know, over here, everybody's always wanting to run away from being black, you know. And, you know, the Hebrews, then you got the Moors. Everybody's running away. Stop it. Be one. Here's a 16th century Spanish description of the Aztecs. This is what the Spanish wrote. The people of this land are well made, rather tall than short. They are swarthy as lepers. I said it before. Lepers, blah, blah. Of good manners and gestures, for the greater part, very skillful, robust, tireless, and at the same time, the most moderate men, you see. Both leopards and jaguars are not usually dark or swarthy, the writer must therefore be referring to those that are melanistic, completely black, or very dark. They are known but the Black Panthers, see. You know, I was reading a thing last night, it's talking about the Taino, and they said, so Columbus came back and he said, we can make these people some slaves, because all they do, they give everything. If you ask them for anything, they'll give it to you, you know, and that's the whole point. We're always giving. We're giving and loving people, but sometimes you have to say no. You have to say no, because, see, people take advantage of us because of our kindness. People take advantage of us because of the fact that we're always thinking about God, and people take advantage of us because we don't have to treat you bad and have somebody over us with a whip or over us with a stick. We don't want to treat people bad because of the fact that we know that we're always under the observance of the one.
Ashe.
The only one. Physical anthropologists use many terms to refer to the African type represented by the Olmec skeletons, Aztecs, and etc. This dancer is called an Aminoid or Dungaloid, Leopinoid, Equinoid. The photo of the last Aztec couple and evidence of African skeletons found in many Olmec sites described as Aminoid by Wersinski and Chan and their trading partners. So this dancer represents some of the way some of the Olmecs may have looked, but also the way some of the Aztecs look. Look at this, and this type of black person is called an Aminoid, you know.
Wow.
The big nose or Aminoid feature of the black Mexicans probably go back to the Sheros and the Ocos. Okay, here we have a picture of the last Aztecs. You know, a lot of times people, they try to tell you that the last Aztecs were mongoloid, and that therefore, not mongoloid, but they were retarded, they try to say. And they say that they couldn't have been, in a sense, related to the original Aztecs. But look at the last Aztecs. The last Aztec couple, they show the same features of the ancient Sheras and Oko. You see, look there. You can see that. Need I say more? The Aztecs belong to the so-called Aminoid black type. Alfonso de Zurita wrote of the Mexicans, the Mexicas. These people are by nature very long-lived. On the one hand, the Mexicans showed what Perry has called a very high degree of social docility, the willing submergence of the individual in the personality of the tribe. But against this must be set a streak of personal individualism with a tendency towards violence and extremism. They were only violent because the people around them kept on trying to mess with them. You know, they always had the Aztecs, that they were always shedding blood. There's always people on the altar. But I mean, hell, look at all those Mongoloid people around the Aztecs joined with Cortez and the other Mexicans to destroy the Aztecs. What were they supposed to do? The only difference between us and them is that we're at war. But we just don't have the means or the inclination to just go out with swords and battle people every day. In a military state like Tenochtitlan, physical bravery was taken for granted, and death in battle was something to look forward to. As a Mexican poet put it, There's nothing like death and war. Nothing like the flowering death, so precious. You know, that's how we felt. I remember when me and my wife were teenagers, and I mean, damn, hell, what do we care about? Dying for the black race, baby. You know?
Absolutely.
We did not want to die on our knees. You know what I mean? You know what I mean, Reverend?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, I do.
Black man on your knees begging. You didn't want That's to right. die. But you didn't mind dying if you had to. You wasn't afraid mm-hmm. to die. And that's the scary part of it. The scary part of it is that when you're not afraid to die, you don't care what it takes to survive. And that's what the Aztecs felt.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This altar depicts the Aztec rain god Tlaloc and was uncovered by an Aztec man at the Temple of Mayaro. It's 11 foot monolith, which is still mostly buried, potentially the more important discovery. Some archaeologists speculate the stone slab could be a part of an entrance to an underground chamber. Yeah. Yes, look at this.
Wow.
This is really an impressive, exceptional Aztec monolith, said Leonardo Lopez Lujan, an archaeologist at the Museo del Templo Mayor. Yeah, they had human sacrifice, but again, I mean, hey, back then, most of Africa had human sacrifice. Remember was the when we talked about the Gymnosophists. It was the Gymnosophists that talked the Merodes out of human sacrifice.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yes, you know, human sacrifice was really popular back then. Well, I wouldn't have wanted to be a king, so everything would kill me.
Not at all.
The Spanish conquistadors destroyed the temple when they razed the city in 1521. Mexico City is built on top of the ruins of Tenochtitlan. The temple was first excavated in 1978 after electricity workers found a giant carving of an Aztec goddess at the site. Remains of the lower portions of the temple complex buried underneath the city have since been unearthed. You can see how so many, you know, I showed you an artifact earlier. We're looking at the statue. You can see how so many of the Aztec artifacts show that they were black, that they were of the African type, but they hide a lot of this stuff in museums. They don't want you to know the truth. Some of the Aztecs were Muslim because they had many mosques. Yes. Yes. You wow. heard me right.
Wow.
Some of the Aztecs were Muslims because they had many mosques. Mm-hmm. These quotes are in my PDF, and they show you where you can find these quotes in the writings of Cortez. Cortez wrote that this great city contains many mosques. Mosques! Or houses for idols, very beautiful edifices situated in the different precincts of it, and the principal ones of which are the religious orders of their sect, for whom, besides the houses in which they keep their idols, there are very good habitations provided. Think about that. See, think about that. You got to remember that these people, they came, these Muslims, they came to Mexico before they had the jihads in Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
Back before the Arabs became, most Muslim women went around butt naked.
Mm-hmm,
that didn't excite a brother.
Mm-hmm.
The Arabs can't put some clothes on them, especially cover their ankles. those white Muslims and ankles is, I don't know.
Question from the audience, beloved.
Yeah, go ahead.
Go travel abroad. Sean is asking, Baba, is Mongolioidism synonymous with autism? Can one be a Mongoloid and not autistic?
Of course you can. You know, that's why we have them. That's how they made it up off the Mongoloid Indians. Remember, they feel that their retarded kids had a more Asiatic look. But, you know, I mean, hey, in the old days, Most of the black people who had retarded children, they usually were young women married to old men with those old sperms.
Okay.
But what happened is that nowadays a lot of young women they let their babies get their shots, you know, before they're a year old. They let them get their shots you know, right after they're born, and that causes autism, especially among boys. That's why you find a lot of black boys today with autism. A lot of them getting those shots, you know, right after birth or before a year, because you don't really build up any immunity most of the time until a year of living.
Mm-hmm.
I want to continue. Cortez continued. All these priests dress in black and never cut or comb their hair from the time they enter the religious order until they leave it. And the sons of all the principal families, both of chiefs as well as noble citizens, are in these religious orders and habits from the age of 7 or 8 years till they are taken away for the purpose of marriage. Again, if you notice, it is this thing about having cornrows, having the matted hair. It seems as though we have that religious tradition where matted hair seems to symbolize something in terms of the religious nature of the people. Maybe somebody out there who's in some sort of a, you know, religious group may know exactly why people, in a sense, or why black people have this thing about matted hair as a way to gain acceptance. Okay, as I said, is that here, Africans and Aztecs, we always like to say, aha, you know, why are these Aztecs and others wearing feathers? Look over on the left hand, on the left hand side. These are Africans. Look at their feathers. And there we see a brother at the bottom. He was a Muslim with a feather and a turban. So when we see people like this Aztec, the middle picture, and he's wearing a headdress, you can see that this wasn't uncommon. What happens is that it goes back to what Professor Childs was talking about yesterday is first sight consciousness. And what she was trying to tell you is that you can see stuff in front of your eyes and you will not believe what you see.
Or at worst, not even have a clue as to what you're looking at.
That's right. How often have people looked at these pictures from the Aztec condenses or looked at this Aztec monument and they just saw and they didn't even see themselves in there? You have a first sight consciousness. You begin to see your presence everywhere, you see? But they have to teach you that you don't have this because they want to make you believe that you have no hope, you have no future. That's why our children rarely learn in their schools. See? Because they're teaching our children, and even we don't see ourselves. We don't see that civilization. We don't see that technological skill. We don't see those abilities. And they're in our face. Here we see a traditional Mandy priest. Look at that. Look at that hat. Look at that hat. He was a priest. He was an Aztec priest. In fact, Leo Viner, he talks about that it was a tradition among the Malinke Bambara that their priests wore that. But who else copied that? You see a lot of those, Europeans took that as a sign of being a member of a secret group or a secret society. But then look, in the middle, we have an Aztec priest. But then when we go all the way over to the right, we see who? We see an Olmec. And he has the same conical hat. Continuity, baby. Continuity.
Love it. Cultural continuity.
See, you guys better check out Marie Stewart's tape.
Yes, you do. Absolutely.
Here's an Aztec pyramid. Okay, on the right hand side, we see an artist's reproduction of some of the. The left hand side, we see an artist's reproduction of the city of Tenochtitlan where the Aztecs were. In the middle, we see one of their pyramids. But whoa, look to the far left. This is the tomb of Askia in West Africa.
Mm.
They know how to build tombs like that. And then look on the side. Look on the side of the tomb basket. Look at those rooms and buildings. And then now look at that. And now go back all the way to the far left. And then you can see they had rooms like that at the Aztec City. Continuity, baby.
I love this.
The creativity of our people is amazing.
Yes, it is.
There's many Mandy words in Mexico, Mexica. You know, many of the place names are Mandy. Like the Indian word that they, when Columbus came, they called their chief Kachik. And that's the same Kachingi in Mandy. Kanda go. In Mandy, it was Kani. Kaniko for a farm. Kunke for a farm. Do you see that? Mm-hmm. The Aztecs, they were showing you, when you really study their culture, they were showing you that they came from Africa. A lot of people get mad at me. No, don't get it twisted.
Absolutely amazing.
That everybody was African, but when there were people in the Americas who were Africans, you have to acknowledge it.
Mm-hmm.
Black Moore.
Mm.
Muslim Christian.
Mm-hmm.
Black Indian. Stop that shit. Be one, baby. Be one. When you separate yourself, when you divide yourself into all those different nationalities, all you do is give an opening for the European to dominate you again.
Facts.
That's how we lost our land in Africa. That's how we lost our land in America. That's why today you don't see no country kicking it over there except what? In Africa, no country kicking it except Zimbabwe.
Mm-hmm.
And then put all type of damn things on in Zimbabwe to make sure they can't make no money. But they're able to feed themselves.
Mm-hmm.
They're not waiting for the European to take care of them.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But every place else, they're all divided because everybody is in their little tribal thing. And my tribe is better than your tribe. And you elected Johnny as king, and he belonged to my tribe. And now Robert, he want to be king. He want to be the president. He belonged to another tribe. So I'm going to kick your ass. Then the European give you a gun to shoot each other.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's the same thing they did in Chicago when I was growing up.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They gave the Blackstone Rangers guns, and then they gave the disciples guns, and they shot each other. Nowadays they don't have to give you no gun. These people they don't have no so they just kill each other anyway.
Exactly.
See? But again, understand how B1 will get you going. B1, we have no allies. There's non-African black people on the planet Earth that are going to be your ally. They get jealous because we are so creative. They get jealous because we can take the littlest things and make them into great things. And it's scary.
So what is the dance of the black giants, Dr. Winters?
The dance of the black giants. The dance of black giants makes place in the race war which occurred in ancient Mexico. Yes.
Mm.
During this war, blacks defeated the whites. The red men, the Maya, served as pawns. The whites were defeated by the blacks. The red Maya probably felt that if the whites returned, they would join with the whites to overthrow their black warlords. I know they were always talked about, the Indians in Mexico, they were waiting for the white man to come. Yes, they were. They were waiting for the white man to come because they were racists. They were jealous of black people. So the Maya have a dance called the Dance of the Black Giants.
Wow.
In the following episode, the apparition of vicissitudes undergone by the white giant who has fallen into the hands of his rival, Amin. So they have, in a sense, the Mayans, they have a dance. And in this dance, They have a person with a black mask and a white mask, and they're both brandishing wooden swords, and they run around each other to engage in a fight, you know. And they are just mimic the fight, you know. You see, the black giant intimidates his opponents by beating the ground ferociously with his sword, while he makes menacing gestures and movements in hopes of touching or wounding the white giant, who defends himself as best he can by trying to evade and riposte the thrusts. Mm-hmm. In other words, that means that the black guy was kicking his...
Mm-hmm.
The battle was suspended in intervals while the giants pay homage to the sun, but is then immediately resumed with greater fury. This just seems like an innocent dance.
Mm-hmm.
They got the black and the white fighting each other. I wonder why.
Hmm. Mm-hmm.
During the whole episode, the black giant maintains a menacing stance, not only towards his rival, but also towards the large audience witnessing the spectacle. Both actors watch each other constantly, trying to take advantage of the smallest error of the other. For whole minutes, they are motionless, like statues. Then cautiously, cross swords as they dart glances around in all directions, as if fearing some invisible danger. Then they come to grips, and each places the point of his sword against his opponent's neck, a tragic pose that lasts but for an instant. Finally, the black giant succeeds in decapitating the white giant because his power is greater. Power greater, baby!
Excellent.
That for the shorty represents the moment when our Lord was suffering under the dominion of the bad spirit. The black giants kill the white giants. You know, here the black giant Han kills the white giant seven. Note the king at one side with his crown, sword, mantle, and triangular trimming on his trouser and sleeve cuffs. I mean, isn't that interesting?
Absolutely, it is.
Why would Maya have a story about the black giant and the white giant?
Mm-hmm.
The scene, in fact, reproduces a contest that took place in Shabaoba between Vakum Unapu and Vuku Kami, in which the former perishes. The head of the vanquished giant is hung in a tree, but is transformed into a guago or calabash. To all appearances, the development of the drama contains excessive details, but in reality, they are profoundly revealing of the native mentality and the thematic unity of the work, which has the quinche. As it is for the short day. That means all the Mayas had this tradition now. Well, is the initial pause when the antagonists scrutinize each other's faces before they fight. A mute scene which the Papua explains to us as the inherent obligation of the combatants to make themselves known to each other by their features. Yes. Back in the day when black people went to war, they said, "We're coming to kick your Then we would have a fight.
They announced it. Mm-hmm.
They made a mistake when they used to announce it to the European. Oh, if you're coming on Thursday, we will be there on Tuesday.
Exactly, right?
Look. This is from the Temples of Warriors at Chichen Itza. What do you see? You see some black people sacrificing a white person. I thought the dance of the black and white giants was just a little fairy tale, just a little story.
Wow.
But look at this reproduction of the temple of the warriors at Chichen Itza. Look who's in those boats. Those are black Indians. Whites. Look on the shore. Who the prisoners tied with their hands behind their back? Whites. Yes.
We needed to know this. Doctor. We needed to know this. Thank you, sir.
This was before Cortez came. And the first time the white man came, the brothers whipped their The dance of the black giant and the white giant shows this period in Mexican history. Ancient Mesoamerican art shows the same thing. This first piece shows black wearing the skin of slayed light-skinned The other pics show light-skinned people in servitude are being the sacrificial victims of black. Think about
Wow.
This is in the temple of words at Chichen Itza. When they're talking about the battle of the white giants and the black giants, they're talking about what happened in the past.
My goodness. What was the consequence then of the black, the Mexican blacks battle with white Vikings?
When I wrote about this, when I wrote about the temple of Itza, I assumed because of the time when the temple was probably built, I assumed in a sense that those were probably some white Vikings. Remember the Vikings that made their way to America? They went up and down the coast. So I think they came to these brothers and the brothers they didn't play, you see. But what happened is that it seems as though those Mongoloid Indians decided that when the white man came, they was going to side with the white man. And that's what they did. You know, when they talk about Cortez having such a few men, and that's how he conquered the Aztecs, it wasn't just a few men. He had hundreds of Mongoloid Indians joined them to take away from the Aztecs what they had. Don't you ever believe that just a few Europeans beat the Aztecs? It was hundreds of Indians.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what they did to the Aztecs after they captured them. After they won the battle, they barbecued some of their asses. The rest of them they just killed, and then they threw them in pits and huts.
Wow.
The artifactual evidence from Chichen Itza does seem to strongly suggest that the conquest of the Americas came about because of a race war. Yes. That war
between
Cortez, the Mongoloid Indian, and the Aztecs was a race war.
Mm.
I already showed you how the Aztecs were described as black folk. Not only were they black folk, they were Muslims. The Spanish had just ran the Moors out of Spain in 1492. That's when the last Moors left. So when they saw those other Muslims, the Aztecs, they said, we got to get rid of these mothers. And the Indians and the Mongoloid Indians were very willing to help them. And they were willing to help them because they thought they was going to get some goodies.
Mm-hmm.
Apparently, those light-skinned people of Mongol extraction saw white Europeans as potential allies and took advantage of the coming of white Europeans to free themselves from black tyranny. They became allies of the Spanish, and for their service, they were initially spared. That didn't last forever, you see? That's why when people talk about all the Mongoloid Indians that died during Mexico, died in Mexico, it's all for me. I can't feel sorry for them.
Because
they joined with those white people to try to knock the black people out of power.
This
is not a mythic tale. The Dance of the White Giants is not a mythic tale of the creation of the universe. It's about the first war between blacks and whites. As a result, the Mexicans Indians decided that they would join the whites in battling the blacks. If whites ever returned, this would explain the Mexican tradition of the return of the white gods. That's why they was waiting for the white gods. They said they was going to get them white gods to help them to take. Why everybody always want to take from us? I'm going to tell you why. Because we're creative. We're inventive. And we're loving people. I'm not saying that there's some people out there who are mean, evil, cruel. But as a rule, most of us are loving and kind. And if you treat us right, we'll treat you right. So you can bet. You can bet if those blacks started killing all those whites must have was doing something underhanded. Those whites must have been doing something sneaky. And that's why the brothers had to kick their... The wine in Spain runs mainly on the plains and doesn't talk about the art. In other words, in a sense,
I love you. I just love you so.
That's the first race war. If you're interested in getting the slides up, go to my Patreon. My Patreon is not that much, it's only $5. Twitter, I sometimes post some history stuff from my Twitter account. And my Twitter is at Dr. Clyde Winters 8. And again, my videos are on YouTube. Make sure you try to check those out. You know.
I appreciate that, my beloved. That was amazing. My. You know, when we think of, when we look at history and we think of Blacks or Africans fighting against whites, we usually just the only thing that usually comes to mind is Haiti. We've never seen this before, and this was absolutely amazing that you're showing that we have this warrior spirit and we defended ourselves. When you showed the slide earlier, 65,000 Africans, Black people participated to fight for their own freedom. We are not docile people. We're loving, but that doesn't mean we're docile, and we will go to war on your ass. And this is why they are have so many damn laws to keep in place, because this is called a race technology. Because if they don't do so, they know exactly what happened in the past. They know. They just haven't. They have erased it or tried to hide it. They didn't erase it, but they tried to hide it from us. But yes, this is amazing work.
It's just like in the 60s when they used to shoot a brother or shoot a sister. Somebody would go out and shoot a policeman.
That's right. See, that's right. You kill one of us, we're going to kill one of yours. Yeah, that's how it was.
Remember the New Republic of Africa, I think it was, they burned them up in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. I mean, mm-hmm. You know, the Black Authority, that's the one thing I hate about the Black Authority. He's always talking about, you can't trust the old nigga. You know, but he forgets. It was my generation.
What?
Yes, the Black Authority said, you can't trust the old nigga. But he forgets. It was my job. We were Black Power. We weren't talking about no civil rights.
Right.
We weren't talking about no damn civil rights. We were Black Power. Many people died. Many people sitting in jail today.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying? You see? But see, when people don't know their history, they don't know. They can't differentiate between the Black Power period and the civil rights.
Yeah. Completely two different consciousness and movements, completely two different levels of consciousness.
Right. You know,
absolutely.
But it's very important. So I want to, I got some stuff. One day I might put together and really talk about the earlier race war. It was the earlier race war that the Olmecs had.
See,
a lot of people, they like to think. A lot of people, they like to think in a sense that Mongoloid people was, they may be shorter than us, those little Pueblo, those people down in Mexico may be short, but they do a good whoop y'all.
Oh, yeah, they don't fuck around. Yeah, pardon my French. Yeah, they don't mess around.
And if they sneak up on you, even more so. They're not going to fight you bone on bone.
Right. Yeah, they going to go like you think, bro. It ain't going to go like you think. If you notice, they're fighters.
They describe them as Black Giants. Isn't that how you would maybe describe most Black people in comparison to most of the Mexican Indians?
Good point. Very good point.
What I want to say,
that is first sight consciousness. What you just the entire presentation, that was first sight consciousness.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Phenomenal.
You have to have a context, and I know some people are saying, why do Dr. Winters do this every week? I told you I'm 71 years old. I'm about to any day now I might be gone. But I want you and you and you and you and you and you to get this information. And then one day you can replace me and you'll do even better work than me. Dr. Charles said I influenced her. Look at all that great work she's doing. See, the majority of us, I can't let her see my stuff. They might want to take it. I got to keep it to myself.
Right. Absolutely.
See, knowledge. Knowing is winning. When you know stuff, you can win. When you know things, you can get that first sight consciousness.
Yes,
when you don't know anything, then your consciousness is third frequency. And when you're really ignorant, you become fourth frequency, because all you can see is the need, the absence, the fact that you feel you got to do this, you got to do that, is very destructive, very very evil because of the fact that you feel that it's the only way you can make it. You shouldn't put yourself in the corner. And see,
right.
But the most startling thing is that I know the black Jews, the black Hebrews, I know the black Indians. A lot of them, they want to try to act like it wasn't no Africans. Africans have always been coming here. The first Africans came here 130,000 years ago. You can't run away from your heritage. Artists have said, I'm tired of being black. I'm really an Indian. Oh, fuck you. I'm sorry. That wasn't an intellectual word. Please. Forgive me.
That was such an authentic slip. That was so beautiful. I love that. It was so authentic. We love your passion.
B-Man.
That's what we love about you. B-Man is his. Okay. Okay.
It's his fault. He did it. That wasn't me.
Oh my gosh. Tears. Tears.
She's talking about dummies. Dummies. Your particular tribe, it was about 5,000 of your asses, but because you kept fighting, it was only 1,000 in less than 10 years. today, you Lenape, you may find only 20 of y'all. Y'all dance around.
Right.
You better join FBA and stop talking that divide. You Moors out there. There's nothing wrong with being a Moor, but that's a religion. Stop it. Yep.
Yes, sir. Please tell them.
Black people have always had many religions. Look at the Aztecs. It was mosques. Some was traditionalists, some was Muslims, but they still stood together. They would be one, baby.
That's right. That's right.
This stuff. That's how the European divides and rules us. Because we separate. We separate. And when you separate, you degenerate. When you degenerate, nothing.
Beautiful.
Be one, beautiful. Baby.
Beautiful, my beloved. Beautiful.
Be one.
Whew. Well, family, you know, this is another one for the books. My goodness. It's like you just got to sit back after watching you and watching Dr. Marie Chen. I mean, this week has been life-changing for everyone. History was made. History was corrected. History was enlightened. First sight consciousness was unleashed. It's been a hell of a week, actually. It's been amazing. And family, this is just the beginning. Oh my goodness, you have no idea what's getting ready to come. I've got a lot of surprises coming to you that's gonna make everybody stand on their feet and say, all right, this is first frequency, first sight consciousness, B1, undeniable, unequivocal. You cannot deny it. Here is the evidence. This is absolutely amazing. My beloved elder, love joking with you on this one. Did you want to do the closing affirmation of power?
I didn't hear that. I'm sorry.
I know. Was my mic on? I think my mic is slipping. I didn't hear anything. Did you say something, Rev? Oh, that's too funny. Okay, family. All right, good doctor. This is what we do every time. We just love it. We have a good time. Let's take a moment and just reflect on what we just learned about us. Let's reflect and look at what we've learned from Dr. Marie Charles and Pi Ratio earlier this week in our human code. We are amazing people. We are amazing people. And that is why we must repeat on a daily basis. I say 7 times a day, 7 days a week. I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.
Family, another one for the books. Another one for the books. It is absolutely amazing. It's an honor. Dr. Winters, I will see you Monday night for our class. I'll talk to you before then as I submit my homework assignment to you and all of us. It has been a blast. And thank you for the tea. Oh, Maxine Grant, I see you out there. What's going on? Words on the street here in the UK that Dr. Winters is doing it. What did she say? Bringing us the goods raw and unfiltered. Yes, sir. So you are in the UK, Doc. You all over the world, literally. But you've got a huge fan base in the United Kingdom and everywhere else on the planet. FBB. We love you. We FBB. Love you. We love you.
Foundational Black Britons.
FBB, that's right,
baby. FBB,
yes, sir.
When you come from Africa, when you come from the Caribbean, and you go to Britain, you're not going to a secret place. You're going home. You better stop letting Tamu make you feel you don't belong there. They run things, maybe, but that's your home. That's your
home.
That's
right. That's your land, home, baby. That's your land. That's going right. Home. Give thanks. Give thanks.
FBB. FBB.
Fantastic. Hotep family.
Black Britons.
We will see you next time on First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics.